Heavenly Father, what we believe very strongly is important to us. We pray that you'll help us to continue to honor the things that are important to us and to those that we care about, even while we look at them, even while we subject them to curiosity. And we pray that you'll increase our curiosity as we do so. Increase our curiosity, not just now, but every day of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll look again a little bit tonight on a little more about what is philosophy, even. Just reviewing. Who can help me to review some of the definitions that we've already given? Very good. Literally, we just sort of do the etymology of the thing, not the entomology. That's no six layers. But the etymology of the thing, the word origin, comes from the Greek word for love and the Greek word for wisdom. And we spent some time unpacking what kind of love and also what kind of wisdom. Thank you for that. So the love of wisdom. The mother discipline, the study area from which the other study areas have all come from in the Western intellectual enterprise. It's given birth to all the sciences. It's given birth to really even to systematic theology. We get our methods even for our theology. Theology is not the same thing as religion. People have been doing religion on and on, but to actually do theology, that springs from philosophy. Yes, sir?
It's the discipline that covers the intractable.
Yes, good. The discipline that handles the intractable things. By intractable, we're referring to things that we don't have any idea how to approach it. We don't have any idea what we would use as a tool. No approach, no method, not even a hint. It's just things we wonder about. It's like right now when you try to think about one more dimension, you try to picture what it would look like. We've got left and right and up and down and in and out and time. But just try to imagine we're the stick characters on the board. We're Flatlanders. What the out there looking at us with another actual physical dimension that makes our whole physics enterprise a subset of the real physics? Well, just try to picture it. What in the world would we do? It turns out that there is a tool. Actually, there's a series of tools now. There wasn't. There wasn't when Plato was trying to get at it. Plato was trying to talk about that next dimension or dimensions. And we'll talk a little bit about what he did with that in his allegory of the cave. We're going to talk about the allegory of the cave. Is that good? You wanted to talk about the cave? About the cave? Seriously? Awesome. cool. I've never had that reaction to the cane before. Where'd you hear about the cane?
Our other class.
Which class?
Brain systems and psychology.
Who was teaching it? So that's it. You're excited about what he said about the cane. I'm going to try to say some things he didn't say about the cane. Are you excited about that? Oh, thank you, Greg. I love it.
Thanks, Greg.
Yeah. So it turns out we actually have some tools that didn't exist at all back when Plato was writing. One of the tools that we have, we already use in this class. When I used the Cartesian coordinate system, I drew a number line and then that up and down kind of number line to make the XY graph. Then I put the Z, so it came in and out, like some of you never have seen it in a math class, right? Some of you have never seen anybody make the Z before, and you don't know how to do the math. It's just a few of you, or most of you, don't really know what Z is really about. And T, for parametric equations, parametric functions, most of you have not done T. Very few of you have done actual math with parametric functions. However, have probably all of you had enough algebra that you remember when you were factoring polynomials. Remember factoring? Some of you actually took some algebra and you factored polynomials, like 6x squared plus 3x plus 3 equals 0, you know? And then you make that y equals that. Some of you learn how to graph it on your calculator and find the minimums and everything as a solution. Some of you figured out how to factor it, and some of you figured out how to use the quadratic equation to solve those second degree polynomials, right? And you know a little bit about what happens if you just, instead of just having x squared, you also have in the equation an x cubed. Then you have an even tougher deal. And you can graph that, but in order to graph that, it has to be a three-dimensional model. To graph that, just does these wire diagram looking things, or you can graph it on your laptop and you can spin it around, and it's kind of fun to make shapes that way. You can make circles and spheres. You make a sphere if you have three dimensions. And then if you add another dimension, you're making things animated. You're making 3D stuff animated. You can actually write little cartoons with a fourth degree function. You can actually, it's enough to have a thing that moves, like a cartoon character, that only takes a four-dimensional function. In fact, when you play a video game and there's, you know, like first-person thing in a three-dimensional, but there's time and people are shooting at you and you're shooting at them and you're exploring the castle or the dungeon or whatever, landing on the planet. Every little part of it has a four-dimensional function, and all those functions add up to create a matrix that is the function, the matrix function of the game. And then it takes interactions from you, either with a joystick or controller or a keyboard, and then you actually are putting value into that function, and it changes the way the function displays. And that's all that a video game actually is. And it turns out, it's kind of all this all is. So that is an example of getting a tool and allowing us to take that now out of just being philosophy and to have it actually be other disciplines. We can use mathematical modeling. We can consider in physics, in astrophysics, we can consider multiple dimensions now. It's a real thing. It's not just philosophy. We've got some tools now, but when there were none of these tools, when no one could ever come up with them, it was intractable, so it had to stay at home. It didn't have car keys. It wasn't allowed out after curfew. It wasn't a grown-up discipline. Had to live at his mom's house. Okay? Any other definitions that we have of philosophy? Have we exhausted the ones that I've shared with you of philosophy? Okay, I'll give you a couple more. These are kind of pithy little aphoristic ones. One of them, I don't know if he's the first person to say it, but William James, probably the first real American psychologist, William James, said that that philosophy was a blind man searching for a black cat in a completely dark room, but the cat wasn't there. Okay? Blind man in a dark room searching for a black cat that isn't there. I don't know if it's originally from him, because I've seen at least three places where people have quoted that he came from, but that seems to be the most important person to have said it that I can come up with. So he said that philosophy was a blind man searching in a dark room for a black cat that wasn't even there. Okay? Does that sort of taste similar to intractability? It's just intractable. It's like, where do you start? And you don't even know if you're looking for anything. You know? Another one. Yes?
Didn't you say something about like a glass wall that you're trying to chip into it?
Yes.
Is that a definition?
That's intractability. It's like if you were a rock climber or a wall climber, whatever. But there's a wall that's actually even leaning this way. There's no holes, nothing prominent, not a hole, not a crack. It's as smooth as a mirror. I mean, there's just nothing. There's no lines. There's no root, and you're supposed to go up it. You don't have suction cups. There's nothing. That's intractability. When you've got that, then you can think about these things and try to come up with philosophical tools, but you have no scientific tools yet. Now, when something that... Yes, Christian?
So I believe that quote that you're talking about was originally by Lewis Brown.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, do you have a date on Lewis Brown? Is he before William James?
Yeah, I think they said it was before 1931.
Well, no. William James is probably before that. William James is a little bit earlier. He wasn't alive yet, and he wasn't alive still. He already died decades before that. But I know there's people that are before and after him that have been quoted. It. Did you say his name was Lewis Brown? I don't know who that is. Do you? Okay. Well, don't forget to give Lewis Brown some credit. Sorry, Lewis. Lewis might still be alive. I wonder if he has a week here. Let's find out who Lewis Brown is. He could actually be alive. Another definition. I can lip sync it. I'll close. Yeah, thanks. Sorry, I wait till we play our movie. Turn the speakers backwards. gonna dance with them. Oh, there's a bass. Let's get a little bass going. they're just ramping up. The other definition that I'd like to give is that it is the systematic abuse of technical terms invented for exactly that purpose. The systematic abuse of technical terms invented for exactly that purpose. And I will give a curt skull to the first person who can tell me who said that, and I'll give you a hint. It was one of the most important teachers of Alan Turing. Very famous atheist, actually. In the United Kingdom, I'm giving all kinds of hints, but whoever comes up with that, I will give you a curt skull. Oh, you got it?
Bertrand Russell.
Bertrand Russell. You got it. Yes. You got a hand. It was one hand. It must have been two, because it wasn't exactly the south one. Indeed. So Bertrand Russell said that, actually, he was talking not about exactly a definition, so we're stretching a little bit. He said, philosophy has become the systematic abuse of technical terms invented for exactly that purpose. I want to talk a little bit more about schema. You remember what I had written up there on Tuesday? I was talking about how the whole schema, the whole idea of reality has actually changed from one era to the next, so that what seems like real stuff, I mean, like when you and I are saying, okay, certain things seem real, and probably you and I would agree. It's like when we're just talking from the gut and we're not being all analytical. It's just like, since we're part of this culture, we kind of agree on at least the shared part of our notion of what's real and what's not real. Now, some of us have changed that by some of our thinking. There may be some people here who don't actually believe that there is anything else that's real unless you can see it with your senses. You just say, no. It's all crap. You don't believe in God or angels or anything like that, and you know, you don't waste a lot of time trying to figure out then, you know, what's everything made out of. It's just stuff, and you leave that to the physicists, but you're skeptical of anything that you can't empirically measure. There's some people like that, and there's some people probably in this room who it's extremely real to you, extremely real, that there's more than what you can see. I mean, you see too many things that are like coincidences. You have a sense of having actually experienced something in the same parts of your experience or apparatus that the senses have to get permission to use when it portrays things to your consciousness, to your awareness. You've had sensory, you know, sensations that have not come through your regular five senses. Is that how many senses we have? We have five senses? Did I count right? Anyone want to correct me on the five senses?
Some people have said we have six, but we lost, that was our spiritual sense that we lost.
So some people have said the sixth sense, like the movie The Sixth Sense. Like that movie, right?
They made that famous.
That made that famous. That's one way to look at it. Okay. Did you want to see how the other sense? Okay, no worries. I'm going to say that all those years that we've been saying the five senses, like sight and smell and taste, and feel and hearing, that's not really all there is. We've got other things that we can tell about. You can tell when you're hungry. Can you not? You can tell when you're hungry. It isn't just that you can hear your stomach growling. It doesn't have to be to the point where it hurts and you're feeling actual physical sensation. It's sort of we can't express it in terms of another sense because it's its own sense. You can feel somehow that your blood sugar is low. You know? And you'd have to kind of use metaphors and allegories to say, well, it's kind of like, it's like when I say, can you taste what I mean? It's synesthetic. But there's no reason to be synesthetic about it, except we're trying to guard the orthodoxy of five senses. Well, that's nonsense. You also have a proprioceptive awareness. You know where your body is in space, and it's easy to confuse that. How many of you are pilots? Seriously, I'm the only pilot in the room. Seriously. Any of you date any pilots? Do we have them? You do.
Well, no, my dad and my brother are pilots.
Yes, your dad and your brother are pilots. So you've been in a small...
Yeah, in an open one.
In an open one? Seriously? Wow. An open one, like a biplane? Front and back? That's cool. You know what happens? If you look down when you're changing orientation, if you fiddle around and like drop your pencil, and you go to try to get something, or your knee board needs adjusting, and you start fooling with it, you can look up, and you can be absolutely convinced that you are straight and level, and you are so not straight and level. That's a scary thing. I feel some of your eyebrows go up when I say that. That's really scary. So you can mess up that sense. Just like you can be hearing things that aren't really there. You can mess up your eyesight. If you cover one eye and then you shine a red light into the other one, and then you look at a white paper, you can go back and forth, one eye closed, the other, and you can see the paper turning blue and then going white, turning blue and then going white, depending on which eye you look at. It's easy to mess with that.
Have you tried
that before? Sure. Well, I wasn't using a strong laser or anything.
Okay.
No, we change the color of lighting all the time. In fact, when you go from outside and then you come into a dimly lit room, the color spectrum is really different. But if you just close one eye, you know, it'll go back to normal as soon as you expose it. But there's other things you can do too. You can wear, there have been experiments where they put glasses on people that make things go upside down. They invert the image. And so people are going, oh, Barmer, everything's upside down for, you know, a few days. And then all of a sudden it's not upside down. Then they take it off and it takes a few days to have things be right side up again without their glasses. Really, the brain just goes, oh, yeah, crap. Oh, yes, indeed. Pain itself. Right. Nociception. That's right. There's also actually mild ability to sense magnetic fields in human beings. Go ahead.
I was wondering, is like your gut feeling, could that be another
sense? The feelings in your gut.
Yeah, like,
yes, in fact, like your gut actually is another brain. It's common among psychophysiologists to refer to your gut brain. And here's the scariest part. It's not mostly your cells. It's mostly bacteria. But it's so well coordinated to compare to the coordination of the neurons and the way they're networked and have chemical signals that the bacteria living in our gut are actually able to release neurotransmitters that make it all the way to our brain and affect us like the neurotransmitters that we produce. It's competing to produce the neurotransmitters that make us do and feel as we do from the bacteria. In fact, we are made up of more non-us cells in our body than our own cells. So our notion of ourself is, plus, in each of your cells, the power plant doesn't have your genetic code. It's a different thing. It's a lot more like a bacterium, and you got almost all of it from your mom. That's your mitochondrial organelles, and it has its own DNA. It's a separate inheritance pattern in everything, mitochondrial DNA. And you can see why you get most of that from your mom instead of your dad when you look at the vast difference in the size of an ova and a sperm. And it's just in the cytoplasm. It's just living in the cytoplasm. And it's distributed per volume similarly in the ova as to the sperm. And the sperm is just minuscule compared to the ova. So there's just thousands of times more mitochondria than in the ova than in the sperm cell. So you get most of that from your mom. It's like that's how you energize. It's like your vitality comes from your mom.
You say that having a sense of balance is like being
yes. Yes, absolutely. We have it's not a hearing process. It's a three-dimensional level, so to speak. Each of the axes, X, Y, and Z, has little innervated canals that are each oriented one way and the other. And those give you your sense of equilibrium. Very good. Yes, ma'am.
If you're saying that we have one of our senses, why hasn't society come out and said like?
They have. Oh. I mean, the scientific community has.
So why don't they teach that?
It turns out that there's a few levels of knowingness. And we'll talk a little about this. This is, we're skipping ahead to a branch of philosophy. This branch of philosophy, known as metaphysics, includes things besides the study of the physical world. And in metaphysics, you have one of the areas of metaphysics is ontology, which we've been talking about, the study of being. Existence, what's real. And another branch is epistemology, the study of knowledge. Epistemology. Now, in our society today, at the highest level, officially, you have what we call scientific theory. Okay? Scientific theory. It then needs to go to a level of acceptance that we call a textbook. And then that's literally how it gets applied. It'll be in the textbooks. Now, you have scientific theories that aren't quite textbook. Not everything references them. They're still in big competition and all of that. There's still some naysayers. It's not 100%. Plus, the power structure in society has no use for it to go into the curriculum. So some of those things, we don't teach quantum mechanics in or relativity-based physics. We teach Newtonian physics all the way through at least high school and the first year of physics in college. There's a chapter in most first-year college, like toward the end of the book, there might be a chapter on relativity, but it'll be math poor, and there will be a chapter on quantum mechanics, and it'll lack math completely, even when you take physics with calculus. So we're still teaching Newtonian physics all the way through until you get into the second half of an undergraduate physics major. And we already know that Newtonian mechanics has already been shown to be incorrect. So it's a funny thing what gets happening in the schools. We're fighting now over what we're going to teach in terms of origins. The person who was just confirmed as a U.S., the head of the U.S., whatever, Department of Education, is somebody who wants to teach intelligent design, at least, alongside Darwinian evolution. That's a big deal for people to discuss that. I think it's intellectually dishonest to teach Darwinian evolution and to talk to people and say, that is absolutely the fact, there's no question, this is it. I don't care what it is you're teaching, you can't teach it like that. Just because nothing is like that. Nothing exists that's like that, especially origins, which aren't subject to the scientific method. You can't use the scientific method to study origins. Period. You can have people that are in a club, like a church, you know, and say, this is what we believe, this is our mythology, and we have a lot of evidence, and we've made it to fit it. But it's not science. It's religion. It's mythology.
I just want to say, all your mitochondrial DNA comes from the mother, none from the father.
No, some from the father.
Mitochondria from the sperm cell does not make it during fertilization. It gets left out.
It does sometimes. Most, it's almost left out, but there is sometimes traces of it. Sometimes. Even in women who've had sex with the men. It's minuscule, it's negligible, but you get so little that it can round to zero. Does that make sense? It's not a single mitochondria. It might be spent, but it can still get in there and it doesn't get killed necessarily. All right? Yes. It is the prevailing explanation in our combined culture right now, in part of the country. It's kind of like the majority of the powerful decision makers in most of this country, and I think it's the majority of the thinkers in Europe, and probably China. I don't know about the rest of Asia, but I think probably the rest of Asia, too. I don't know about South America. Probably, that's probably going to be kind of similar here. And Canada, I'm going to say, is probably more like Europe than here. I think all cultures that I've ever looked at or read about have some, where do we come from, basically, in their model of reality. Remember I said that in the 20th century, we're not 100% sure what life to use. We've got some people who are still in the axial era and still concerned about death. We've got some people who have fully moved to where they're concerned about rationality, the Enlightenment thinking of the British Enlightenment, from the Renaissance kind of on, things have been changing. So some people are still there. And then you've got modernists, and then you've got postmodernists, which is just bizarre. Now you've got postmodern. And each of us has pieces of every one of those things that I just mentioned that seem like the fact of the matter to us. Such that if we tell the story, if someone says, hey, I came from Mars, explain to me reality, I don't know anything. Or when you're raising kids, who knows where they came from, but here they are and they're asking questions about everything by the time they're two. Daddy, there's a question mark just everywhere. And that's awesome. But then you have to say stuff. And it helps if it's not all wrong. Although it'd be humorous, you could just teach them all wrong. I taught my daughter, since I just loathe eating raw tomatoes, I loathe them. Loathe entirely, like the Grinch. So I taught my daughter that they were called yuckies. So here's my daughter, little funny little thing with her blonde hair everywhere, running around in one of the ladies' shoes that's about this long to her in the potluck. And then she went up to somebody's place at the potluck and pointed to their tomatoes and told them that they were yuckies. And they wanted to, it was somebody really grouchy too, it was a Bible worker at the church where I was pastoring, and Bible worker was indignant, was pretty certain that I was going to go to hell. And that's not been established yet. So you could teach them wrong, but then, I did two of those projects, one with a daughter and one with a son, where you teach them everything. And my son even took this course. actually even one of my philosophy students. So was my wife, by the way. My wife, when she was getting her master's from PC, she was one of my students. I did not grade her papers. I had the TA grade her papers. It was hard because I was trying to explain each of these things from all these perspectives to them, and then say what my perspective was on it, and then say, but you're going to have a perspective on it. And it's not, we don't pick at random like, let's flip a coin, because that's nonsense. I mean, you do the best you can to be better than me. And then I told them, I expect you to get to where I'm asking you about your areas of expertise and then putting more value on that than what I've gathered, because you're an expert in that thing and you're the other one is an expert in this stuff. That's true now. There's things that each of them know that I don't know at all. I find myself picking up the phone and called to ask to bring me up to speed on that a little bit. In my PhD program studying consciousness studies, there's an aspect of consciousness studies that's the medical consciousness. And my daughter is a nurse anesthetist. And so she's done a lot of work in how we define and detect that. And she's up on the literature for like functional brain imaging of under anesthesia and all of that stuff. And so I don't know about that stuff. I have to call her and get her perspective before I move forward in some of my pursuits. And my son has a master's in international epidemiology, a master's in public health in international epidemiology. And so when I want to talk about the epidemiological spread of something, I need to talk to him about the math. He's also a good statistician, and I'm really weak. So there was a time, though, where we're kind of standing around the kitchen making nachos and eating them and drinking soda, you know, until 3 in the morning, and they're asking me about metaphysical things, you know, and they're asking me things about origins. They're saying, well, Dad, you know what our church teaches about this and that? You know, well, Mr. So-and-so, the Bible teacher, you know, he said this, and but then so-and-so said that, and science class, and what do you think about that? And I'm going, are they asking me to tell them what's the actual thing about this? You know, and I say, I actually do believe that we were created. I think that the notion, and I'm trying, struggling to give them something that makes it make sense, because they're building multiple scaffoldings, and then they meet and can't fit them together, and then they're supposed to build a building in there. And I said, you know, I think that what we can possibly know is going to be like watered down for us living in flatland on a chalkboard, sort of. And we're going to be able, I believe, at some point, have an expansion of that. Like the passage that says, now we look in the mirror and it's all distorted. They didn't have mirrors as good, but, you know, 2,000 years ago. The mirrors just didn't exist perfectly smooth like today. You could get a better reflection sometimes with the lighting just right on a real smooth pond or puddle or something. So the mirrors that they had, though, were kind of atrocious. And it wasn't just dim, it was also for a funhouse, you know. You could maybe say, oh, shoot, I'm bleeding. At least I think that's blood, you know. And you don't know which picture of your face to, you know. It was bad. So the illustration was, we're just seeing a faulty image of it now. And you know, we're seeing a shadow that's cast, and that's the best we get, like the cave. And I said, then we're going to say about people's opinions that we disagree with, we're going to look at it and go, oh, yeah, you could say it that way, I guess. It's not really further off than mine, I guess. And then people go, look, you were so sure of yourself. Now look. It was like, you know, if you look at your own opinion of how things are, even if you're explaining it using exactly the same words, and your friend or your brother or your sister or your dad or your mom, whatever, they would explain it using the same words, then you assume when you say that word that it means exactly the same thing to them, that they have the same experience on the inside that you do when that word is said. But that's probably not true for any words. For any words. You try to explain to a blind person what is red, the color red. This person was born blind, they don't see. What are you going to do? What words are you going to use? Now they use the word. That's actually easier for us to get our mind around than to recognize that we don't have any way at all to say that you're experiencing red like I'm experiencing red when I see it. Even if we can agree, like on little color shade things, yes, that's red, that's, and you're not colorblind, we can hide the colorblind confusion things on a background and then put a character and ask if you can see it and tell the difference, and some people can't, but there's somebody who can. They can, all those things that can be discerned with a pattern, you can and they can, but you still don't know what it's doing, what the experience is. In fact, it's hard enough to just figure out what's the experience that I'm having. For me. Right now, why don't you think about what it's like to experience the color red? What's the experience? What does it do to you? What words would you use?
Hot.
Hot. Okay. Like a frozen cup of tomato juice. Now that's gone. So you identify it with hot because we use blue for cold, and like when we do a graphic of the thermometer, right? Mm-hmm. And that's kind of synesthetic, isn't it? It is. Some people, like the book, The Man Who Tasted Shapes. Have you heard of that book, The Man Who Tasted Shapes? All of us have a little bit of, well, most of us have a little bit of synesthesia. Is there anybody here that doesn't mind saying that you are full-on synesthetic? Anybody here that actually has, your senses do run together a little bit, and you think of certain sounds as, are you?
Oh, no, I just had a question. Maybe taking psychedelics, would that be the same thing?
Well,
We'll talk about psychedelics. We'll talk about a little later. We'll talk about LSD and mushrooms and DHT, whatever. DMT, ayahuasca, peyote, and holotropic breathing and meditation. And the God helmet, and a whole bunch of other things. We'll talk about some of those when we talk specifically about consciousness. Good point. We don't know when we do these things. We don't really know whether or not we're actually like turning down a squelch so that we can perceive things that we're kind of designed to block. We might actually be seeing, experiencing in our brains, in our consciousness, somehow we might actually be experiencing off the chart. Which is bizarre because the sort of the theme in people's descriptions of these experiences when they have them sound uncannily like what the math that we talked about, using like extending the Cartesian coordinate system and matrix algebra and all of that. Their descriptions line up so well that it's frightening. Ezekiel saw the wheel of the flaming chariot wheel, like wheels within wheels, flaming way up in the middle of the air. There's a spiritual about that. Ezekiel saw the wheel way up in the middle of the air. Ezekiel, you ever heard that spiritual? That passage sounds so much like the first descriptions people gave. That's almost using the same word for word as the earliest descriptions that came out of Bell Labs, New Jersey campus, the first time we're aware of human beings did a like a animated computer screen generation of a tesseract. They described it in terms so similar to what Ezekiel said when he was given that vision, that it would appear that Ezekiel saw a reflection of the fifth dimension. Why chariot wheels? Think about a day when things that had 90 degree angles in them and straight lines were much less common than they are today with all of our manufactured stuff. One of the only things that would give the particular distortion patterns that make sort of patterns look like an entity of themselves that's not there with curvature, like taking two window screens and putting them close together and moving one, you can picture that sort of flowy, weird, those patterns, they didn't have ways to generate those, but I'll tell you one way they could have. One, just thinking about the items that were likely in their day. I'll be right back. I haven't forgotten. You picture a chariot with spoke wheels, and you're down sort of off of the levee, and it's the wheels are at eye level, and it's backlit. And it's also making a little bit of a turn, so the wheels aren't going at the same rate because one's covering more distance on the outside of the turn. You would then, that would be one of the only regular occurrences where they would have this weird thing. When the wheels stopped, they'd see that it was just straight spokes. But the pattern that was generated would look like an animation. So wheels within wheels, chariot wheels flaming way up in the middle of the air, I think he was shown something that was very much like given just a little peek into the next dimension.
You had mentioned a tesseract. Is that?
Tesseract is a five-dimensional solid in motion. Okay? All we can get of it, though, is a shadow. Remember, I showed a shadow on the board? A shadow has one less of the physical dimensions. Can still have time, because we can't get out, we can't get off of the time thing unless we like take a picture and then we stop time, held it static. But we don't even know how to draw the shadow, really, of if time was the dimension that wasn't getting represented, what you would have is you'd have the thing in the same place, maybe, or a different place, all within our observational ability. Like, it could be more than one place at one time, or it could be more than one time in one place. Does that make sense? All at once? Remember this? This is a snapshot. This is like taking not a movie picture, but a still shot of a tesseract. And you can go on YouTube. You can go on YouTube and search for tesseract, and it'll give you some animated tesseracts. Some of them you can stop and start, you know, and twirl them and look at them and everything. Others just run as a movie. It's just like some. If you Google it, you can find some places where you can change some of the parameters. I think you put some of the math in yourself.
Used to be.
Yes.
When talking about the sensors, do you think it's possible to increase the range of data we can intake?
Yes, we can create new sensors. My son has created a new sense in his body with a magnet. He's put a magnet in his hand. And so he can sense magnetic fields. It's not a feeling anymore. It's not like, oh, I feel that. It's like, well, how do you say it to people? It's like talking to a blind man to say what red is. He senses magnetic fields. Period.
What about things like being able to see beyond just like the visible?
Well, a bee does that. A honeybee does that. Sure, when we buy night vision, which you can get for like 50 or 60 bucks for paintballing on Amazon, little plastic ones, but they work, you're doing that, right? Some of our video cameras and drones and everything that we can get, you know, under $1,000 have got night vision. Our security cameras all have night vision. If, you know, pay $40, you get night vision. You can sit there and watch in real time on your iPhone stuff that's infrared or whatever. I've seen what it looks like in the police helicopter, the FLIR, the forward-looking ultraviolet or whatever, or infrared, forward-looking infrared. It looks, depends on how you display it, but it's represented as monochromatic, but when someone's been there, you can see their heat signature that they left behind, so it's pretty cool. You tell where they have been.
So what about when you feel someone's talking?
Yes, very good. In fact, it has been demonstrated with scientific rigor, to significance, not overwhelming significance, but to significance, that people can tell when somebody's looking at them. And here's the bizarre thing. It doesn't have to be just like line of sight. It works on a video monitor in another location. It doesn't even have to be in the same country. Cool, huh? There are weird things that we don't understand. There are weird things. Some of them are maybe good, some of them are maybe bad, and some of them are dependent on how they apply, you know? Like a hammer is a good thing. Not on a skull, but it's a good thing when you're putting wood boards together.
What about detecting a thing that you can't see by spiritual?
Is it possible to, well, do you believe that God can talk to you? God could say something to a person. If you believe that God could do that, then you've answered your question. Then you'd have to believe that it's possible. You're sensing it somehow, right? He installed a strong magnet, very small little glass encapsulated magnet into his hand. So he has a friend who's a surgeon, and he also has. An RFID in his hand so that he can open his car door and turn his car on. And when he comes to my house, my front door, the devil can be opened by his hand just waving in front of it. It reads just like Apple Pay. Yes.
TSA,
it doesn't do anything. No, it doesn't.
Also, I was wondering, have you read the book A Wrinkle in Time?
No.
I read that in, what was it, eighth grade, and it talks about tesseracts and the folding of space.
Would you email me the author and the title? I want to look at that. That's a new one for me.
It's also a movie, too, but the book's
Did I already pay you for that?
Yeah.
That really deserves it. It's a movie?
Yeah, it's a movie.
Find me a link.
It's a horrible movie. It's horribly edited. It's terrible. The book's much better.
Okay. Send me the thing anyway. If you could be, are you an English major? Okay. Because if an English major says, no, don't ever watch the movie, they just say that because it's part of it. My wife's an English major. She's an English teacher. The animation was weird?
Yeah.
Well, maybe we can redo it. Who's the film literature people? Who's the filmmaking students here? Where's our filmmaking students? You might want to make, she said it's bad, you might want to make it good. A Wrinkle in Time, there you go, there's a project. That's all the thing, remaking movies now, you know? So now they're remaking them while people faster than they can get them out on DVD and get them sold.
It's
like, well, maybe it's just because I'm getting older. It's like, wait a minute, that's the third round. They're getting at some movies coming out the third time. Do we really need that? I thought we handled it. Let's see, there was another thing I wanted to make sure that I had mentioned. Well, let's talk about the cave. In what I think is the most famous thing that Plato wrote, he wrote a lot of it, but one of the most significant things that Plato wrote is called The Republic. The book, the story, is a utopia. He makes a utopia. That's like an ideal society. Now, in order to have a good society, you have to assume that having society is good. So that's a given. Not everybody believes that. Some people believe that it would be better to just everybody move out into the forest and live as survivalists, you know, become more primitive, so that because they see civilization as a bad thing. That would Plato and Socrates are not to be numbered among those romantics that believe that. They believe that it was a very good thing to have civilization. Now, utopia, the prefix "u" means good. Euthanasia is good deathism. EU. Utopia, though, is only the letter U. U-T-O-P-I-A. U-T-O-P-I-A. Many people have written stories that are about their idea of what it would be like if things got organized right, if it got done well instead of crap like it is, in their opinion. They always believe it could be better. So they go back to the drawing board and they either reassemble things in their concept, in their imagination, of how life should get organized, how cities or cultures or families or countries or whatever should be organized. And if they have to, they use a device. Like if something's, in order to be good, they'll dip into science fiction or reach up and get science fiction to help. Like, okay, well, we've come up with a way that this can be better. Now, if you watch the various iterations of Star Trek, you can see as they travel around to different places, they come to different societies and different planets and different galaxies where people had organized things in some ways better. And even in on Earth, things were organized in some ways that were, they thought, better. So Gene Roddenberry organized some utopian concepts. I think that anyone who is writing a utopia is doing philosophy. I mean, because that to do utopia, unless you're just like rehashing a formula, you know how you can write a script that's formulaic? So all you do is like just update it and plug in his name isn't Dirk, it's Bob, and her name isn't Sally, it's Cindy or whatever. You know, you just change a few things around, and it didn't happen in Cincinnati. It happened in Portland, you know, or whatever. That's not philosophy. That's just cookie cutter. It's cookbooking. But to actually do either utopia or dystopia, I think you're having to do some philosophy. Definitely. If there's anything creative about it, you're doing some philosophy.
But would you consider them like the first one to kind of...
No, because the Republic is a utopia, and that's long before him.
Like, to fully, like, develop it more.
Well, the Republic was pretty specific on Now, there's things that he did. And then later, B.F. Skinner was even more. So if you thought that the threshold of legitimacy came with B.F. Skinner and Walden too, then Utopia wouldn't make the grade. You know what I mean? It's gotten more and more, and we've had some things that have in the last couple of years, we've had some dystopian and utopian movies that have come out, some stories like Ender's Game and things like that, right? You've seen some of the ways that they present an alternate to even some video games. The backstory has either dystopian or utopian constructs, but they're very different than they are today. They've reorganized things. Now, some people set out not to just write a story about it, but to make it happen. People that formed communes in the 60s, there were hundreds of communes around the country where people would take their kind of people, hippies, and they would go off and try to get as far away from wherever they could and not be bothered, and then they would reimagine the whole social structure, like who does what responsibility, or are there some functions that don't even need to be done? And they would have notions of who owns stuff and social structures and sexuality and how they relate to the outside world and how they relate as far as do they have structure? Do they all live in one big tent, you know, yurt or whatever? So people are still doing that, but there was a real surge in trying to have a utopia, a mini utopia in compounds like this. Some religious cults, even today, are still doing this. They still set up, you know, utopian societies. The Mormon Church was kind of one big utopian experiment, and then basically the state of Utah got its start from that whole, got its start from a religious society that was set up saying, we'll redesign the way society gets done. So in the Republic, though, Socrates and Plato, and that's a fuzzy distinction, keep that in mind, they had a beef with democracy already a little bit. After Socrates died, and you know how he died, right? Plato tells us, in great description, he tells us about this guy, Socrates, that he'd been a military general in a war that Athens lost. Athens was an unusual place that was set up democratically, not like our republic is set up here with the, sort of the play-like democracy here, but really democratically. They would have two boxes, and they would propose something, and the citizens that were eligible would be there to hear the proposals, and then they would vote one way or the other on them, and they have a voting, like rocks or chips or whatever, coins or whatever, and then they would put it in one box or the other when they went forward, or have, depending on which story you get, have more than one kind of token, and to put one token in one or the other, depending on what they're for. And they would decide all kinds of stuff like that. In fact, that's how a jury trial was conducted. Well, Socrates was somebody who wanted people to not to just accept the way society was doing stuff and just go along with it just because people said, or just because that's how it was. He wanted everybody to be thinking about doing things on purpose and always trying to come up with a better way. Try to look at what's wrong with everything that exists and not just go along with it. You know, if you rethink it and you say, yeah, this still is the best we can think of, then we'll hang on to it. But he was ready to let go of anything. He wanted to encourage other people to be ready to do that. And the people he found the easiest to seduce into his way of thinking, to infect them with this curiosity, was young people, usually young men. And he would start talking to somebody, and he'd ask them questions, and he would get them to tell their answers to it. And then he would just ask more questions. And he would have a clever way of asking questions so that he could get them to say what they thought about something. And then he would kind of sense, I'll bet you they've got competing ideas. Their construct doesn't make sense with itself. So he'd ask another question and get their answer. And, oh, they know the answer to that. And then he would say, well, you said this. Yes. Well, then you said this. Now, how do those go together? They don't really go together, do they? You can do that to anybody. Jesus did that to people that he was talking to. Jesus used the Socratic method many times. You know, when you look at his dialogues in the Gospels. Well, this got people to be kind of going, maybe things should change. Maybe some of the ways we're doing things, that's not good. Today, you have a strong generational tendency, and you can see in some of people's concerns for civility and civil rights today, whether it's racial or it's immigration status or it's gender and sexuality, right now there's this foment, there's this battle, and it looks to us as Adventists in the Adventist community, we have a tendency to say, oh, well, look at how stupid, you know, they don't this and they don't that and everything. But it's going on. That's just a reflection of sort of the water that we're floating in. Because it's the whole country that's having this discussion. The election that we just had has brought out a demonstration that really not any of the issues that you see within the Seventh-day Adventist denomination are special within the Seventh-day Adventist denomination. They're not special at all. They're going on with people who don't care about any church stuff. They're going on in other countries. They're going on in the species right now. But if you look at young people, it's just an overwhelming majority of young people that take a certain flavored position, and most older folk disagree with the position. Would you agree with that? Not all older folk. I mean, you've got some really old folk that are really progressive or really liberal. And you've also got some young people that are like president of their campus's Young Republican Club. And they may be skinheads to boot, you know, and homophobes and misogynists and the white power people and all of that. But you feel right now, anybody here that doesn't feel that our society right now is having difficulties agreeing, older and younger people or people that live in certain kind of county, another kind of county, you drive through some areas and you're going, I'm not getting out of the car here, you know. Or you eat in a little diner or something and you go, oh, just pay and get out, don't say anything, you know, I'm out of here. And it happens on Facebook. Is there anyone here that's unfriended anybody in the last few months? Because you're just going, I just can't go there. I can't go there, and I can't have you go in there, because I see it, and I can't see that. Right? This feeling was taking place very similarly in Athens. There are many parallels between Athens and here. Between Athens and Socrates' time, and here in your time. There's many very, very similar things. These were real people, and they had real population, opinion, tradition dynamics like they do today. And so people could, they've been raising their kids a certain way, I want you to pretend that you go find some young people, like over at the, like, eighth graders and ninth graders, and you go talk to them down at the market when they're having their food from the market deli down there, eating candy bars and soda, and you're getting a sandwich at the deli, and you start talking to them, and they've got very conservative Adventist parents, and you start asking some questions of them, and they're going, no, my dad says da da da, and so you ask another question, and they say, oh, I wonder what your dad would say about yada yada. Well, he says, no. Well, do you agree with him? Yes, we agree with, and we should this and all, and it may be something like, it may be a matter of like saying all lives matter. You might have some kid down there who's saying all lives matter. And you're saying, do you realize how you're dissing a cause when you say that? You realize how you're minimizing, you know what you're really doing? See, but you don't argue it. You ask questions, and the person goes, after a while, they go, that's true. And you kind of infect them with thought. You make them think rationally about it. Like, put their ideas together that don't really fit together, and you show that by just asking and asking, and they're going, oh, well, how does that fit? And they're going, oh, it really doesn't fit at all. No, it really doesn't. Well, you better go ask your dad about that. So pretty soon they go, ask your dad about that. And then the dad is saying, you are going to take a paper bag lunch, and you're going to eat at those picnic tables right out there by the flagpole at prep. Now, you don't go down there with those dangerous college students. You know? If you were babysitting somebody and you pulled that, you would get one shot at that babysitting gate, right? That'd be it. Well, Socrates is going around town, and he's going to them. He's finding where they are, and he's doing this. He's making them question things about the power structure, and there was haves and have-nots. Yes, it was a democracy, but you had to own property or you couldn't vote. You weren't part of the democracy. In fact, if you weren't a citizen, so if you didn't own property and you were an immigrant, you got nothing. You got no rights. You can't vote. You don't get a say. You don't get nothing. Nothing. If you're a woman, nothing. Nothing. So, I mean, we've got some people today who are on to a real similar kind of dynamic. And so Socrates is going around asking people questions. Now, I'm only talking like politics, but what about religion? He's asking them questions that he might have religious implications. Now, he wasn't a person who was an infidel. He appeared to believe in the gods that were acceptable in the time. In fact, his last work, his last statement that we have is when he would, and I'm skipping ahead to tell you this, we'll come back and tell you how we got there. His last words when he was being executed, he got the death penalty, and he was taking it willingly instead of escaping when people were willing to help him escape. They kind of expected it. They're kind of like leaving the door open. We don't want to do this. Just go and go a long ways from here. And we'll just say that we were overpowered, whatever. Everyone kind of expected him to escape, and they're kind of not guarding him real carefully, and even kind of like leaving the door open, like, go, stupid. But he's going, no. I believe that people need to keep their contracts, and I have a contract to follow the law here, and if the law condemns me to death, then I'm dying. Don't tell me to go back on my word when I've said we need to be consistent with society's laws. I will keep those laws. And I've always said that, and I'm not going to throw my whole program down the chute just because it's inconveniencing me. What inconvenience was, it was death by poisoning, and he needed to drink tea that they made out of hemlock leaves. That's how they were going to kill him, and that's how they did kill him. That's how he killed himself, executing the order when the time came, when it was time for his sentence to be carried out. But after he drank it, supposedly, the last thing he said was to one of his students, we owe a cock to Asclepius. Please don't forget to pay the debt. Asclepius was the god of healing and some other things too. But there was a sacrifice of a chicken that for some religious ritual. Said, we owe a cock to Asclepius. Make sure we pay the debt. And so the poignancy there is that one of the things that was on his death warrant for the reason of his execution was that he was an infidel, that he was against the gods. He didn't believe in the gods, and he was anti. So nevertheless, you can believe in God, and still you can jerk up some young person's theology so that the parents are unhappy about it. That's not hard at all. You know, in Adventism, that's like low-hanging fruit. You want to goof up parents' concerns and get them really to run you out of town on a rail, then start messing around when you're a youth minister someday, you know. So many youth pastors have sent their young people home with stuff that makes their parents have to go take Pepto-Bismol or a nitroglycerin tablet or something. They're not happy when you rewire the philosophy that they've been trying to put into their kid's head, and they think that they're on the right track, and all of a sudden their kid comes home and he wants to be a hippie, you know. Now, he's been really conservative. He comes home and he has 71 piercings and those little stud things coming out, and he's got tattoos on the face that you can't even cover with sleeves and everything. It's like, you're never going to have a decent job in an upstanding Republican business now. What made you do this? Well, you know, I was talking to Socrates. Who? I was talking to Socrates. Well, what did he tell you? Well, you know, a lot of things. He was just asking me questions. Well, stop it. And so they warned him lots of times. He screwed people up. He'd go around, and he wasn't just doing the young people, too. He'd go find the parents in their business, and he'd say, I see that you have a sign here that says, whatever. That's interesting. That's a good thing, I guess. What do you think about this? And they answer him. He'd go, Well, then that makes me wonder what you think about this. You got this other thing going, and they're going, yeah, so? He goes, yeah, how does that, and they're going, get out! You know? And he went around just messing with everybody, and his shtick was, he'd go around kind of like playing the Columbo card. I don't know if you've ever seen that old crime detective. You can see it on Netflix or YouTube. Got a trench coat and got a cigar. It's like a million IQ, but he would act like he was an idiot. He'd come and say, I'm not too smart. Gotta help me. He's always acting helpless. I don't have a match. Or, can I get a glass of water? He'd come right in and say, I've got to use your toilet. You know, and he just totally disarmed people because he's like bumbling. And I don't have a pen. Can I use your pen? And what's that word? He'd say, what's that word? And he's like, he doesn't know. And he said, I'm not smart like you. I mean, you're a surgeon and everything, and I'm just a cop, but help me here. I can't make sense of this. And so they go, okay. So they get a chance to show how much they know. He's going, that's probably over my head. Try it again. So you make it, because I'm kind of stupid. And they tell him, I think I understand that. Well, here's another thing I never get. Would you explain this to me? And they'd explain it. He'd go, if you said this, and now you're saying this, boy, I know I'm really slow, but I can't make those two things fit together very well. Help me explain how that goes together. So he went around saying to people, I know that you know a lot of things. But he said, I actually think I'm ignorant. I'm really ignorant, so I need you to help make me less ignorant, because you're not ignorant, are you? And they'd say, no, I'm not ignorant. He'd say, I'm ignorant. I just don't know very much. I think I must be the stupidest man in town. Would you help me understand this thing? And so, okay, sure. So they get their back all straight and start waxing eloquent, and he'd go, I think I understand. Well, you know, be patient with me. I'm not that smart, and you're obviously really smart. Would you tell me one more thing? Tell me about this. I heard you say something about that once, and they explain it. See, if I was smart like you, those things would all fit together, but I can't make them fit. Could you help me see where those fit together? And they can't, of course, because he's the smartest man for miles, and he knows exactly what he's doing. So anyway, they got mad enough at him, finally. Somebody made some false accusations, because it was really hard to stick anything on him, because what he did was just ask them questions. Well, what's the harm in asking a question? Isn't it free to ask? He wasn't telling them they were wrong. He would just ask them one thing, ask them another thing, and go, help me see how that fits. And they couldn't make it so that it fits. So he's going around town just upsetting the whole lot. And what are you going to do? You going to put him to death or send him off, you know, or put him in jail or whatever because he's just asking questions? But everyone kind of knew he was doing something. So they made up some charges. One of them was corrupting the youth. And another was that he was an infidel. He was speaking against God. He was promoting atheism. So all these charges, there's a big trial, and you see some interesting use of logic and everything, and you see some of his philosophy brought out in the story of the trial, and you can, it's worth looking at the trial of Socrates and his defense and everything. But the Republic is being written probably after he's dead, and so Plato is pretty unhappy with the government and with democracy, because what it was is it was real easy to have some, ready for this, fasten your seatbelts, ready for this, alternate facts. It's really easy to have some alternate facts in the courtroom and to then have all the people in town, you just say it over and over and over until, and just, you say any ludicrous thing and you just act like it's serious, and here you are in a courtroom. They weren't there for the incident that's being claimed because it didn't happen. So of course they weren't there. And if you're going to make up something, you don't make it up as if they were, you say, you were there. No, I wasn't there. You say, nobody here was there, but it was this guy who you slipped a $50 bill to, and this guy who you slipped a $100 bill. And they'll tell you. So they tell, and if everybody's there is like, well, I don't know, I wasn't there to not see it, right? So in the end, it was really a matter of who was willing to lie the best. And that's all you need to get a majority vote. So we have Plato in the Republic first. He wants to tell us what's so heinously ridiculous about democracy. He wants to make the point that a democratic polis, city-state, government, whatever, is always going to be ridiculous. I mean, all the decisions are made by the 51% stupidest people and the 51% least wise and the 51% least honest-minded. And he thought that was a formula for definite failure. It's like mob rule, he said. So he had this illustration that has come to be called the ship of state. Tells about a ship that is journeying across the vast ocean out into who knows where. And there's a captain, and there's a navigator, and there's able-bodied sailors that are just the grunt workers, and they're not all that bright. And the captain of the ship of state is his big thing is he wants to be sort of liked by everybody. He wants to make sure that the guys like him and will include him when they, you know, playing darts and drinking and messing around. And he wanted to make sure he was a popular guy and everything. But the one guy who, it wasn't a popularity contest, it was the navigator. He was using the sextant and the stars and the maps. Now, it doesn't really matter whose friend he is if you go around in circles until you run out of food and water, fresh water, and you're dead. You need that one dude to be a solid dude. Don't mess with him. Don't drink with him. Don't buddy up with him. Don't tell him you'd rather maybe have a turn to play with his maps or anything. Just get out of there and leave him alone. Or you're not going to get where you're going before you get dead in the ocean. Not a fun place. No, you can't call for a helicopter or for the Coast Guard to come and reprovision you or reset your GPS equipment. It's not like that. You are out there, and when it's night, it's dark. And you could be have, and all you see is water in every direction. That's it. So this navigator would also be somebody who would be able to read the weather a little bit too. He'd be the smartest person on the ship. So as they're going along, the navigator gives some orders that require a lot of changing of directions and a lot of having to move into the wind. And it's a hard thing for these sailors. And they're exhausted, and he keeps giving these orders and everything, and they start to complain. They say, can't we just for once go the other way? Can't we just go with the wind now and then? He says, what are you, crazy? No, we can't do that. We have to go the right direction. We're going to use the wind when we have the wind. Now we're so tired. Can't we just give us a couple days off? Well, you got to understand, these voyages were seasonal. You got to be in the right place in the right season, or you're not going anywhere. If you get halfway and it changes seasons, you're dead. Dead? Dead. You need to just, once you get it underway, you need to go with it until you get there. So as it goes along, they start complaining to the captain. And they want him to come down and spend some time with them and say, hey, we need some days off. And, you know, can't we just for once let someone else decide? I mean, you're not a very good leader. You're letting him tell you what to do all the time. And the captain says, well, that's kind of a good idea. His advice is kind of important. No, horse manure. We've been on so many, we've never died at sea. Not one of us has ever died at sea. Have you ever died at sea? No. That's a bunch of baloney. We're not going to die at sea. That's other idiots that die at sea. We're not idiots. We're not going to die. We know what to do. We know how to stretch our provisions. The navigator is just keep those idiots away from me. And he's just this. You, when I say that we need to go a certain direction, we need to go that direction. That's it. Just, I can't make sense to them or of them. Just get them out. So this tension increases until finally these fools seduce the captain into drinking with them and kind of taking their side. And he's wants to be popular and everything. And so they finally had enough, and they toss the navigator and decide that they'll appoint one of them to do it. Because, you know, they've seen him, he sits there and he holds the thing up and everything, and it's just not a good plan. So, but they said, that's our government. Now, that was not this week that anyone wrote that. I want you to know, this was a long time ago, okay? This was like 2.5 millennia ago. This wasn't in 2007, right? See how little there is new under the sun. So the Republic, after he wadded up in his mind and threw away the notion of democracy, he said, so what would be better? Not that, but what would be better? He said, well, and then he spun out a picture of what he thought a good city-state would look like. In his mind, the people that should be in charge, it shouldn't be like the prom queen and the prom king. It doesn't matter if everyone thinks they're cool or they're hot. They needed a philosopher to be in charge. And people are immediately like, well, what? Of course you'd say that. You're a philosopher. He'd say, no, it's not. I don't want to be in charge. I mean, I want it to be somebody who at least gets it. Well, who gets it? Well, I mean, the philosophers get it. What do you mean by get it? So he said, well, you can't see it. It's out there. There's the ideals. And they're going, what? He said, okay, look, it's like this. And that's when he told the allegory of the cave to make that point, which I am leading up to. He said, picture that there's some people who, from the time of their birth, a lot of people, there's this wall down deep in a cave, windy passage all the way down. There's this opening cavern place, and there's a flat wall, and these folk are chained in place. Even their head is in a device that holds them, and they're chained up, and all they can do when their eyes are open is look at the wall. They can't look very far to the left and right, except you kind of see and talk to the person next to them, like if they strain, but it hurts your eyes to do that when you kind of heads in the thing, so you look straight ahead. And all you can see is the wall. And on the wall, they're seeing shadows. Just shadows, like shadow puppets. And there's like a play, and like it's like shapes of animals and shapes of people and you know that kind of thing. Shadow dance on the wall. And as it turns out, they don't know this, but behind them there's a fire that's lit that they keep bringing wood and putting into the fire. Never goes out. It's brighter sometimes than others, and it dances around like fire. So that makes, you know, when you're doing shadow puppets out of the fireplace, they kind of move with the fire. So it's even more confusing. And in front of the fire, there's these people whose job it is to hold up these, like, shades, you know, and to do the thing. And they're putting all kinds of stuff up on there, and it's like, you know, maybe there's a manual that they're going up. Okay, now I put this one. Now I put this one. And so they're doing these plays and everything. And then one day, one of these prisoners gets himself loose and turns around and says, "What the heck? What? You mean that's not real? That's you doing that? Son of a gun! You guys, hey, you see what they're doing? Shut up, man. I'm watching. I'm coming to the good part." No, you're not coming to the good part. The good part, let me undo. Don't touch that. Don't touch that. No, dude, seriously, you really got to turn around. No. And so this person wandering around, looking at how they're doing it, is coming back and saying, "You guys realize that things aren't really flat? You guys realize that there's actually depth and everything?"
So kind of like Matrix?
Yeah. Neo is the guy. Neo is the guy. It is the Matrix. The Matrix is the Republic. Yes. And so what's even more of a mind blower is the dude goes past the fire and the guys with the shadow puppets and everything goes up and out of the cave. Oh, and the sunlight is so bright. Burn his eyes. He hardly makes sense of it. Doesn't even know what he's. Green grass and flowers and birds and everything and people running around. And it's like, are you kidding me? We're in a hole in the ground. And he runs all the way back down there. Get out. "Hey guys, do you know what I saw?" "Shh. Come on, man. You always do this. We're coming to the good part here. Let's see." No, you need to. And they're like, "You guys are discussing whether this guy ought to be killed. It's been up out of the..." So, mystics claim that when they have mystical experiences, they first realize that we're looking just at flat wall. Remember what you asked? My father, when he was a philosophy student at UC Berkeley, they had the students take LSD. It was used in schools. Psychology and philosophy professors did that. And my father describes that before he took it, nothing seemed real. And afterwards, it seems like not for the rest of his life, now he seems like, "I can't imagine, you know, that I've ever thought that..." One of the things he said is, that he continues to say, is that all of the categories that we have appear to him to be so absurd and invalid that he can see that there aren't any actual distinctions, that everything really is the same thing. And that seems to be a theme that runs through many mystical experiences. Some have substance involvement, some have meditation, some have shamanic drumming, some people have... hypnosis has been involved in some of that. Whatever. Some people also have spontaneous things like that. Maybe a stroke. little bit of an aneurysm or head injury or near-death experiences where somebody codes or they stop their heart on purpose so they can do some procedure and then restart it, you know, whether it's vascularity in the brain or they're doing heart procedure that requires them to, like, shut them down. People that have drowned in cold water and been brought back. There's this theme of everything's kind of just, you know, one thing. And people have drawn, Christian mystics have drawn comparisons to the things where Jesus talks about how he and the Father and the Holy Spirit are really the same thing. And he wants all of his followers to be one, to realize that they're one with him, one with each other, and everything's just oneness. So this whole idea fits with some people's mystical experiences. Now, the unfortunate thing about using substances like that is a caution that one of the real serious researchers, Stanislav Groth, cautions. There's no guarantee that what that's going to be your experience when you mess with these things. You could have the experience of becoming mentally ill forever or just dying. I've met people who've had bad LSD trips and they're crazy. And it wasn't a good experience, it was terrifying, and they're stuck in terror mode, like, forever. Everything is terrifying forever. And I kind of think I get a chance to be one person, and I'm just not willing to monkey around when there's any odds of that kind of funny business happening to my whole business. You know, whatever it is, if I can't find some way that doesn't have a pretty good chance of screwing me up forever, I'll hang on and get that another way. You know, so I want to urge you never to take risks with crap that can wreck you forever. It's just not worth it. It's just not worth it. You may have something spontaneously happen. If, you know, you have a car wreck and you have a head injury and then, you know, you're in a coma and you're brought back and you describe these things. You know, don't hope for that. The downsides are, you know, outweigh the upsides a lot. However, when people have the experience, it's rather interesting, I find, to ask them about it, anything that they're willing to tell me. So, in this allegory, there's so many things that can be drawn from it. One is what an example that I just gave in our discussion, because you raised the issue of LSD and what it can be consciousness. It's possible to look at the Christian notion of conversion. You know, when you have a conversion experience, the Holy Spirit comes and changes you so you're a different person. That degree, a type of enlightenment could be like getting around and looking at the people doing, you know, the fire. I realize that there's more to it all. You start to have another whole perspective, like you start to believe that there's really more going on. And then everything changes in the way you think about it. Politically, though, Plato said there's no excuse to elect somebody to be a government leader that's got their head in the vice that thinks the back wall is all there is. That doesn't make any sense. How can they lead you constructively? They're the idiot sailors who will toss the navigator into the waves in the night. You just can't afford stupid in office, according to Plato. I'm talking 2,500 years ago. I'm not making any contemporary political statements. This is philosophy and not politics that we're talking about here. In fact, though, possibly Plato's Republic is one of the earliest and most important political works of political science ever. It asks us as a species to begin thinking deliberately about politics and doing them on purpose instead of just sort of noticing what happens to be. Applying philosophy to do it on purpose, skeptical of whatever we're doing now, trying to find the best way that we can do it by any means. Please pick up your quizzes before you leave. They're all right there, all neatly organized. And I will wish you an amazing weekend, an outrageously wonderful, unusually good Sabbath. Indeed. I'll be going this weekend to San Jose to hear Aubrey de Grey speak about the ethics of achieving biological immortality. It was speaking with the San Jose State Institute of Bioethics, joint with the SENS Foundation. He's one of those cutting edge legislators.